all we need to worry about there. If you do have a question towards the end, that's when you can turn your mic on and make a noise, and you will pop up larger, and we'll invite you to ask your questions from there. Okay. All right. Look, just to introduce Kate, fantastic to have this opportunity to meet with Kate and to follow Kate on her next exciting expedition. From there, I could talk for quite some time about Kate and her achievements to date, but there's a lot of stuff on the blog, and I hope that you've gone to the blog, kateleeming.global2.vic.edu.au, and go onto the blog, read some stuff about Kate. And something that you may not be aware of is that Kate works as a real tennis professional. Now, real tennis, you might never know what real tennis is. And so, hence, I think that's a great little research topic for you to have a look at. If you don't know what real tennis is, check it out, have a look at it. She has been ranked world number two in real tennis. She's won 5 Australian Opens. So you need to find out a little bit about real tennis. Apart from that, she's travelled a distance twice around the world riding push bikes, and certainly not just riding down a concrete road. So you certainly wouldn't say that about when you've ridden across Australia, when you're riding across Africa, and now when she's embarking on to ride across Antarctica. All right, so no more, I don't think, for introducing Kate. Here she is, she's sitting there and waiting and ready to rock and roll. So, Kate, it's over to you. And I guess she'll invite you to turn your microphone on, and we shall hear your story. Over to you.
Great. Well, I've been really looking forward to sharing this story with you, and hopefully you'll be able to follow it as it goes through from my next expedition in Yukon, which starts next week in Canada, all the way through to cycling across Antarctica at the end of the year. So, but what I thought I'd do first is just show, talk a little bit about my background, and you know, ultimately we want you to be able to plan and do your own expeditions and activities. So this should help you, inspire you to do that. So I'm going to share my story first. So everyone, you know, has probably ridden a bike before, and probably just to ride to school or to ride to the shops or for a bit of fitness. And that's kind of how I just started riding a bike. So how did I go from that to now, where the sum total that I've done is about twice around the world at the equator? I don't know what you're thinking. You're probably thinking, ah, she's mad looking at this. And I used to get quite offended when people used to think I was mad, because it was pretty tough. But now I learned to take the positives out of this, because the only way to get through is to really think of the positives. So here I think of mad as standing for making a difference, which is what I try and do with each of my expeditions. So I grew up on a wheat and sheep farm, and actually one person who inspired me very much to travel by bicycle was my great-great-uncle, William Snell. And in 1897, he became the second person to cycle across Australia when he cycled from the goldfields in Western Australia across to Melbourne to propose to his childhood sweetheart. And luckily, she said yes, and they got married, and he put her on a boat bound for Fremantle, and he cycled all the way back again. And so growing up in Western Australia, I had a in the country, and I went to school there, and then I went to boarding school and university in Perth, and I had no idea what could be achieved on a bike until I went across to the UK the first time just playing hockey, and after that I did a little trip in Europe, and then little trips led to bigger trips, and over the space of the next couple of years I did about 15,000 kilometres through Europe, and that was just really my personal discovery of Europe. And I guess this is where I really discovered my passion. So I guess the reasons why I really love to travel by bike, I really love the connection that you make with the people in the land. It's very strong. I love the idea of bringing a line on a map to life. And I find that traveling by bike gives a great sense of place, a real perspective of how the world fits together. And I was actually here on this trip up to the Nordkap, the most northerly point in Europe, where I got this idea about cycling across Russia. And then I started planning this journey, and then I met this fellow called Robert Swan, who's a polar explorer, is the first man to have walked to both the North and South Poles. And it was Robert who really inspired me to understand that there's much more that I could do on a bike. There's much more value to what I was doing. And so the next year I cycled, became the first woman actually to cycle across the whole of Russia from St. Petersburg to Vladivostok. And this time I chose to aid children affected by the Chernobyl disaster, as there was an extra value to what I was doing. And this is a picture of us very excited arriving in Vladivostok. We found some champagne in a shop just beforehand. And we're ecstatic because we got there a day ahead of schedule, actually, after 5 months, and we got through swamp. There was 1,500 kilometres of swamp where we had to push our bikes along the railway line. I broke a rib on the step. And the whole country was in quite a lot of chaos. So to get there one day ahead of schedule was an amazing thing, and everyone was safe. So in fact, all of my journeys, so Russia and then Australia and all of them, and then Africa, have all finished on time and on budget, so, and with no major injuries. So I thought that, you know, this is a really good chance to explain how I put an expedition together. And so the first thing about all of this, and I'm going to explain this as I show you a bit about Africa, the first thing is to really create the vision. So find the things that you're really passionate about, and to find things that you're quite good at, and then to really work out what's realistically possible. It takes quite a lot of research to do this. And so for Africa, I'd always, you know, loved the idea of travelling across Africa, but I never really, you know, there was so much media around Africa being a very difficult place. I didn't really have the confidence to go there. But now I thought other people cycle there, so let's look at Africa. And so then I was looking, because I have a real passion for the importance of education. And I was looking at this map, which is showing levels of education in Africa. And you can see this band of countries crossing Africa, kind of from west to east, and that were in most need of improved education. Then I started thinking of this idea of cycling across the whole of Africa, putting together an education program and learning about why kids don't have the same access to education over there. And then when I looked into those reasons, I looked at poverty and realized that actually you had to look at all the reasons about poverty and not just education, because they're all interrelated. So my journey ended up being this incredible journey through 20 different countries, and it was 22,040 kilometres and over 10 months. And you might be laughing here thinking she got lost, but actually I didn't, because what I was trying to do is I had to make this whole thing work. I was linking up with all sorts of different organisations that had different issues, and I was wanting to learn about all these different issues in Africa. So I linked up with 10 different organisations, had 15 different projects to visit during that journey to understand why people are in poverty and what it is that they're doing to move out of poverty, and how we might be able to help them. So you can imagine organising this was just incredible, probably the toughest thing. So you've got the vision there. I've got this mission to cross Africa, to make the first crossing of Africa from west to east. No one's ever done it before in a continuous line. And really trying to create this story about learning about Africa and giving a realistic perspective of the whole continent, or 20 different countries anyway. So that's kind of the vision. And so 18 months it took me to put all that together and to find 30 different sponsors. It was a real struggle. It was so tough, I hardly had any time to train. Obviously, I'd done a lot of other things before, but it was just the toughest thing to get to that start point. We had an education program here, and lots of schools were following me as well. And so I was really proud just to even get to the start point. It was such a struggle. And that's the most westerly tip of Africa there. And then this time, because I wanted to film it, I had to get a team around. So normally I've carried all my sort of bags and things before and carried all my gear, but this time, because we're filming it, needed a bit of extra help. So there were 7 different people in my team at different times, and without that team, the whole thing wouldn't really work. So the most important person there was actually John, the guy next to me in the middle, because he was the driver of the support vehicle, so he coordinated all the support. And Daniel started cycling with me. He's a guy from the UK, and he came for about about 3,000 kilometres before he got injured, actually. and that Paddy was our first cameraman. So very quickly we set off into Africa, and it was really straight out there into these, meeting these incredible people in all sorts of different cultures. Here we might as well look like we're from outer space, because you know, this was near the, on the border between Mali and Mauritania, and we'd just sort of come out of the dirt and the sand, and they didn't quite know what to think of us, but we were always really, really welcomed. And then another time, just a little bit further on, we're just having lunch under a baobab tree, just this beautiful tree, and it was just, there was just a little dirt track, and these are nomadic women and children here, Fulani children. And they were really a little bit scared of us. They came over, and when the boys got up, they ran away because they're a bit scared, but they didn't seem to be worried about me. So I sort of got up and got my camera out of my bag and just sort of took a photograph of one of my friends and showed them that it doesn't hurt. You know, just showed them the picture of Daniel in the back of the screen of my camera, and suddenly they all wanted their photograph taken. So it was quite incredible, actually, because that lady there in the green, who's probably only about 16, I'd imagine, 16 or 17, she suddenly noticed my silly cycling suntan. And so she sort of looked up, she picked up my shirt and looked underneath to see what colour I was underneath. She didn't quite know what, she was just totally, she'd never seen anything like it before. So these are kind of really special interactions. And then again, later on in Cameroon, meeting some different people. There's only about 3,000 Koma people that live in the mountains between Nigeria and Cameroon there. And so here I was tasting some little, they were little dried figs, actually. They were tiny little wild figs. They were really good, actually, to tell the truth. Now, what you've got to imagine, doing any expedition, whether it's Africa, you've always got to think of the big picture. You've always got to think, okay, there's a time limit here. Everything's got to work for the education program, for getting to the finish on time. There's a certain budget that I have to keep to. So therefore, I can't just sit around all the time and just take my time. I've got to get on that road. And I was averaging about 130 kilometres every day I went out cycling. And some roads were obviously better than others. And so it was always important to stick to the task and stick to the goals, and whatever those goals are, of course. So obviously, I fell off a few times, got injured, doesn't really matter. There's only a bit of skin gone here, nothing much more than that. And then to cross the equator twice, we had to cross the tropics. So there were obviously some very bad roads that we just had to keep going no matter what. And a lot of people ask me, did you ever want to give up? And there's a very common question I get. And to be honest, the answer is not really, because I really believe in the vision, and I have the mission, and I've really committed so much to it already. I have so many sponsors, I have a lot of people following me, and so just because of all of that, I would never want to give up. So you've really got to think of, can I keep going? And if I can, and obviously I can keep turning the pedals, it might be a bit slower. That's generally the process. So mentally, I have to get through these things, you know, just thinking, well, this is a really bad day. So, you know, what do I have to think about? Well, often I was thinking about what would it feel like to just be cycling across those incredible Somali plains at the finish. And then I'd work back. That's like still, at this point, I'd still had about, I'd only done about a quarter of the journey, so we still had about 17,000 kilometres to go, so it's kind of a bit daunting. So if you just think about that finish and then work back, right down to the month, the week, the day, just to get through this hour, then just to get to the next top of the next hill, just to get to the next sand dune, just to get whatever it is, right down to, and I think what really, really matters, if that when times are really tough, what gets me through is if you can really look at the beauty in your surroundings. That'll really help get you through. So one of the issues that I looked a lot into was actually girls' education, the importance of girls' education. I won't go into too much about that right now, but it was really important to visit lots of schools and initiatives to see, because a lot of kids don't have the same access to education that we do, and also sometimes in various societies, the girls' education isn't valued as much as the boys', and that's gradually changing. I learnt about lots of incredible initiatives, and lots of things are changing, but there's still quite a long way to go. So that's something I want to work on in the future as well. And so just to quickly take you across to the other side of Africa, this is just going up through Kenya, in the North Kenya here, just this terrible stony desert for about 400 kilometres of that, before coming into Ethiopia. And I want to share with you, I divert an extra 320 kilometres off my main route and into the Ethiopian desert here. And I met up with an initiative up there, this lady called Valerie Browning, an Australian lady, who's been there for 30-odd years, and she had an initiative with her husband. And these people, the Gafar people, probably are some of the poorest people on earth, but yet, and they're nomadic. But here, this was the first time that they'd sort of gathered together, and they were just at their inaugural youth conference. So it was just an incredible time. I was very, very lucky to be there and to see that. Here they were just acting out a traditional dance. And the girls, the women would have had no access to education. Suddenly now they were literate, they were really taking part, and it was just a wonderful expression of freedom here. Then into Somaliland, and this was normally in places like Somalia especially, you know, if you had a disability, like these girls were deaf, you'd have no opportunity. But I came across this Hargeisa School of the Deaf, and these girls, you'll never guess, but they're actually, that's Somali Sign Language for Australia. So I thought they were having me on to start with, but they were avid that it was. Now, so just a little bit about Somalia, which was where I had to finish my expedition to get to the most easterly tip. And this country's been in war since the early 90s, essentially, and varying amounts of it. And so I guess what was tough here, so I came into the border, and this is probably the best planned bit of the whole journey. I'd been talking with the government from Puntland for about, even before I started the expedition, so I had their confidence. Somalia was in such a state, so the only bits that were controlled by the central government were those blue bits on the map. And this is when I was about to go into the country. The yellow bits are Somaliland, which is a sort of a safer area, and that's kind of runs as its own country. The brown is where I had to get through Puntland, which is kind of neutral and still safe. And the real problem was the green stuff. That was being controlled by extremists. And so for us to get through and to get across, essentially had to follow the main road with a lot of support here over a buffer zone, because Somaliland and Puntland don't get on that well. Through about 700 kilometres from Garowe, which is the capital, past those Al-Shabaab training camps up there, and into Hafun at the finish. So this time, the Puntland government really supported us, because some of them were Australian Somalis, and they went across back, they got their education over here, and then they went across back to Puntland to serve their country. And so they treated us like family, myself, my cameraman, and my sister who'd come with us. They treated us like family, and they put their whole lives on the line for us, essentially. And this was the president loaning us his very own special forces, which was amazing. So we were protected by the soldiers, two bulletproof vehicles. The last 400 kilometres or so, we just had to go through tracks. And it was a bit like going across the Nullarbor Plain, really. And to get to the finish, getting quite excited. Hafun is an ancient town at the end of this isthmus. And so it's all sandy and so on. And then we had to go up onto that mountain and across this plateau to get to the finish. So here I was getting quite excited, to be honest. I'd broken my wheel a little bit, but I was still just dragging that bike to the finish. And that was the team at the finish. So there's all those soldiers, and it really was an incredible team. My cameraman, my sister who joined us for the last bit. So just to get to that finish, you know, obviously I was absolutely ecstatic. You know, we'd gone through this idea, this whole thing, that was my idea, my vision, my mission. Mm-hmm. We come right through, all the way through to realising that goal, arriving 4 days ahead of schedule with no major injuries. But it wasn't the end of the mission, to be honest. So from now, I had to think about analysing all of that and writing it down in a book. We made a feature documentary film about it. and they're still making a TV series. It's taking a long time, a bit frustratingly. But so my mission is to also be able to share these stories so that other people learn from them. It's not just for me. So I'm going to share with you now a little video. It's like a four-minute video about Africa. Okay, so this will give you a real taste of what the whole thing was like. If we just go from there. Hopefully the sound is good. This was a journey like no other, a world-first achievement. For me, it was a quest for knowledge and understanding. I rode 22,000 kilometres over 10 months across 20 African countries, facing just about every condition under the sun. My name is Kate Leeming. I'm a sports professional, an adventurer, and an explorer. On this ride, I had to confront the realities of some of the poorest people on Earth. I'd like to take you on that journey to witness these challenges, but also be uplifted by the spirit and the astonishing natural beauty which is Africa.
Well, I guess I love to travel and see parts of the world by cycling, and there's no better way of seeing a country. You get just an incredible connection with the people and the land.
We're going along at quite a steady pace now, 22, 23 k's an hour. Trying to do a big day today, 130 k's, 135 k's. If we keep going at this pace, we'll be just continuously cycling for about another 5 hours.
40 degrees every day, seriously hot, and my body wasn't quite up to condition, so I was struggling physically for a while there.
I can't keep any food in my system, so I'm just going to keep drinking. So much for shortcuts, bloody hell.
So how are you feeling?
Shit. Mm-hmm. There's no energy.
Oh, did I fall off? I'll show you the injuries, they're pretty ugly at the moment.
This fellow here has just been sharing the shade with us, and while he's been sitting here, he's just made this rope. And it's simply just made out of palm fronds from the local trees here. I'm also very passionate about education and the importance of education in this world.
We'll be able to teach family planning, we'll be able to teach all sorts of things, which will work towards safe motherhood.
Maybe with time, things can change.
So the rebels attacked them, they took their cattle away, they took all their property, they killed their husbands and their children.
An adventure which hopefully you'll be inspired to learn more about Africa. It is about the causes and consequences of extreme poverty, but in particular the positives and what's being done to give a leg up rather than a hand out.
So you get through all of that, and so you've done the vision, the mission, the organisation, the execution, the analysing, all of that stuff. So what is there left to do but create a new vision? And that's what Breaking the Cycle South Pole is all about. And I like to keep the idea of keeping that same name, Breaking the Cycle, because I want to link the two expeditions. Obviously, Breaking the Cycle is a bit of a play on the fact that what I'm doing is quite difficult on a bike, but also talking about breaking the cycle of poverty. So this idea about cycling across Antarctica really started. I was always interested in Antarctica, but never in the past had it even been possible to think about cycling across it. And then gradually the technology had got a little bit better, and so I started looking into it. And initially I went to North America to learn, you know, what kind of bike would be the best kind of bike, for example, to take across Antarctica. Obviously it had to have the big fat tyres, and anyone who's ever done any sand cycling in the desert, like I have crossed the Canning Stock Route before, everyone since then has used a big fat tyred bike, increases the flotation. So I looked into this, and to cut a very long story short, after hundreds and hundreds of emails, I ended up meeting this fellow based in Philadelphia in the US who had made mountain bikes that were two-wheel drive or all-wheel drive. So it's a bit like a four-wheel drive vehicle except on a bicycle. And it was a very clever design. And I managed to contact him, and he liked the idea of making his system into a fat bike. So he made me a very special fat bike. This was it being welded up, the very first one ever. And then I needed to obviously be able to test the bike and myself, because I'd never been in the extreme cold. I was very good at the extreme heat, but not the extreme cold. You know, coming from, you know, the country in Australia, you sort of, it's good at the heat and good at plus 40, not minus 40. So I got some specialists together. I got Eric Phillips, who was a polar explorer, an amazing polar explorer, Australia's best polar explorer, and a really top filmmaker, a Swiss filmmaker, Claudio von Planter, and a photographer, Phil Coates. And we went up to the island of Spitsbergen, which are Norwegian islands, about level with the top of Greenland, so they're almost 80 degrees north in the Arctic. And now I'm just going to keep I'm going to run this film, but I'm just going to talk over the top of it. So this is just taken from the pictures that the photographer Phil Coates took, and what you'll see how tough it is to really cycle in these conditions, because it's almost like doing interval training the whole time. You sink down, have to work very, very hard, and then you get some firm stuff. And the other thing I had to do there was really, let's turn that down a bit. Yeah. So the other thing I had to really do was test the clothing and work out what kind of clothing that I needed to do. Anyway, so this was an amazing journey, and basically from that little journey in Spitsbergen, we determined that cycling across Antarctica was possible, but we needed to improve a few things. And so after this, I managed to get some more funds, and last year did a journey essentially across northeast Greenland. So it was the first time anyone had ever done a journey in northeast Greenland. So a journey on a bicycle, that is. So this was another test. A second bike was made, a better bike this time with wider tyres, and it all seemed to work very well. I tried some different clothing, learnt quite a lot more, but unfortunately the Greenland, it was melting a bit early, and so it wasn't really as cold as we wanted it to be. It was only between about 0 and minus 10, and so I really needed another test. So in the meantime, it was quite an exciting place to be. There was polar bear tracks, which were, luckily we didn't see the polar bear, but we had to carry precautions. And you can just see, this is Claudio filming me on a gimbal camera, but you can just see how much I'm really, really working, even with the good bike. And it's so tough. It's about, you know, if I could average 6 to 8 kilometers an hour, I'm doing really, really well. And the two-wheel drive system's incredible, because it doesn't, you think it might be more difficult to drive it, but actually only when the back wheel slips, the front wheel grabs, and vice versa. So it's a very, very clever system. And it was also probably one of the favorite rides I've ever done in my life. That was the finish of that trip, coming out to the ocean. It was perfectly calm. And that was my birthday last year, actually. That was where I spent it. And just this privilege to be able to cycle out to Cap Tobin there at the finish of that journey was unbelievable. So next, this is where you're going to be following what I do, but so coming up, to get a much bigger test, and it's going to be colder where I'm going, breaking the cycle Yukon. And you can see we're going above the Arctic Circle there. It's going to be temperatures around about minus 20-ish, and it's going to be a route of about 1,200 kilometres. Maybe it depends a little bit. I'm going to do an acclimatisation ride from Dawson City, which is looks at like there, like it's in the middle of the Yukon. That's very famous, that part of the world, for its the Klondike Gold Rush, something you can look up maybe. But there was a big gold rush there back at more than 100 years ago. And so that's Dawson City. And so I'm going to be taking a road from there, that Dempster Highway, up to Eagle Plain, which is just a gravel all-weather road, about 400 kilometres that is. And that's where we start. And that'll be off track, so it'll be off-piste. So it's going to be pretty tough work, but it's going to be exciting. There's lots of history there. We're going to meet some of the local Indigenous people, especially at Old Crow. And I'm working this time with a Canadian guide who's been guiding around here for 40 years. So he's still alive, so he must be doing something right. So I really trust him. And Claudio, the filmmaker, is coming with me as well. So we're all going to meet there. And that I will be sharing my story with you. So you'll be able to follow that on the site. Next, though, just to give you an idea where we're heading for, this is a little bit about Antarctica. Now, the plan at this stage is to late November, early December, start at Leverett Glacier there, which is on the Ross Ice Shelf, cycle about 600 kilometres up to the South Pole, and then down to Hercules in that down the other side. And so anywhere where you cycle towards the South Pole, you cycle into the wind and uphill. So the South Pole's at almost 3,000 metres altitude, so it's very high. So starting at sea level, the first bit will be very tough. And then I'll be following it's not a real road, but it's a flagged route that some US, a convoy uses every year. So it'll make it a little bit easier, but it'll still be very cold, very soft, all the way there it'll be into the wind. Heading from the South Pole down, that'll be with the wind, but some of the conditions will be rougher in terms of the softness of the snow. There's no track or pseudo-track to follow either, so that'll be quite tough. So that's really the physical journey. Now, a little bit more about why I'm doing this as well, other than obviously contributing and being able to share my story with you and for you to be able to do some of your own activities. I also really felt compelled to do something more about Africa, and learned about all these initiatives. I met some wonderful people, and I was trying to put something else together to use this to raise funds for an issue. And now I think I've just about cracked it. I've almost got a partnership worked out where I'll be going to be supporting, and you might like to raise some funds for this. Supporting access to education. There'll be more about that as it develops. I can't really announce it too much yet, but it's quite exciting. And for me personally, to be able to use this expedition to support, you know, the people and places that I travel through is just, that's kind of why I do it. So that's where we are with that. There's a little bit, very quick, that's the timeline. There's a couple of things. I might not be going to Morocco now because I don't think we have enough people on that trip in May. Lots of training, another altitude training coming up in September. The whole issue with this is obviously I still need to find enough funding to make the whole expedition happen. That's the hardest, that's the toughest thing of the whole lot. So I'm continually working. Even when I'm up in Yukon, I'll still be trying to keep things going. So it's kind of a tough gig, but that's kind of what it takes to make these things happen. And just to finish, I've got a little saying which I always like to show at the end of all of my talks. So if you're dedicated, realistic and enthusiastic towards your goals, show a positive attitude, then you will achieve your mission. So that's kind of a bit of background. And maybe now we could maybe have some chat. If people have some questions to ask or, that would be great. So fire away if we've got some.
All right, that's fantastic, Kate. Joanie, thanks for that. We've got lots of questions. We had lots of questions in the back channel chat from Hawksdale. And we'll certainly get a lot of those questions to you. Have we got any questions from any of the schools there? Or Bost, have you got any questions? Marino, have you got any questions? Kate?
Yeah, who's going to go first? Am I convening this? Or yeah.
It's cost food. It's Peter from Orbost. How do you carry all your food?
How do I carry all my food? Do you mean in Antarctica or in the snow?
Hey, Colton.
Yeah.
Because it was different. So it's a different time. So obviously that getting all the food, it's a good question because it takes a lot of planning to get all the food and we'll put all those food in bags. I'm not carrying all the food on my bike this time because it's already very tough and that soft snow to carry any extra weight. So because we've got the cameraman and we have snow machines in Yukon and in Antarctica there will be a vehicle. And so the food will basically go in there. On the bike though, I have to carry some food. I have to carry, because I have to eat all the time. So I have a little jar and I have sort of some, In that bike in Greenland, you saw I had some sort of mitts over there, and they actually not just good for keeping your hands warm. I can also put extra food in there, so I've got extra chocolate bars and lots of energy food and nuts. And in that jar also, I'll have things that I can almost like drink it, because if I've got a plastic jar that I can drink from, it's very difficult to even eat when you're going along when it's very cold, because you've got your hands in mitts and you can't just like, you've got no manual fine motor control very much, so you have to kind of find ways to be able to eat the food. It's not that easy. So carrying the food is a bit harder than most people might think.
Right, that's great, thank Marino. You. Any other questions? Marino, did you have a question?
Yes.
Yes, Marino, yes. Go ahead.
Do you actually get stuck in the ice?
Get stuck in the ice? The ice bit is actually the good bit because the ice is firm. So if I have to go over ice, I can go quite fast. Sometimes I put little studs on the tyres. I haven't done it yet, but if it's really slippery ice, I can do that. But when it's the hardest thing is when you hit the soft snow. That's where I sink down. If it's really, really soft, it doesn't matter how good the bike is, I have to push. And that's very hard work. One day in Greenland, I had to push, I covered 25 kilometres and I had to push 20 of them. That was a really tough day. So that was pretty hard. But a lot of the time it won't be that bad. It was just, that's just the nature of what it is sometimes. So it's not the ice, it's actually the soft snow that's difficult. And even with the ice you get sort of ridges, and it's what's called sastrugi, which for a vehicle, it's really difficult, but my all-wheel drive bicycle eats it up for breakfast. It's really good. So soft snow is the worry, and that's what we can't predict. Like up in Yukon, it depends how much soft snow we get. So just, we don't know exactly how far I can go every day. We want to do 50 or 60 kilometres, but that'll be all day.
What got about going across now. The Antarctica? How are you going to find the route that you take? Did you take it across Antarctica?
Yeah, so we'll have we'll certainly have navigation stuff, equipment. So we have the trackers and we have GPS, that kind of thing, compass, all of those. We have several. We don't just have one item, one device. We have lots of different devices. And because I don't have to navigate, so it's not so tough for me, because actually we will have a vehicle there, but I still have to be able to know what I'm doing. On the way up, we're following a known route. On the way back, we'll also have the waypoints, so we'll be following those and punching those in and following those and keeping together. We know roughly where the crevasses are in Antarctica. They're kind of mapped out, and the crevasses, which are one of the most dangerous things, tend to be at the edge of the continent or where there are mountains. So the finish is probably the most dangerous bit of the lot, the last 25 kilometres, but we have a route through there that we the vehicle probably won't be able to go through. We'll have to go separately because the vehicle could go down. And the bike is not the best thing for crevassing. We need to make sure we have a plan to avoid them.
Yeah. And have a plan. So it's all going back down to your planning and your pre-planning process.
And then common sense as well. Like, you're not sure, you wait and you see. You know, if you make a mistake down there, there's no one. Well, getting help is very difficult. We will have a system also for getting help, and we could be pulled out at great expense. And we'll have communications to tell the people that we're in trouble, but still, we don't want trouble.
No, but, don't. You know, so and we hope to be able to follow your journey there, Kate, and follow along with you and possibly get some connection with you along the way at some stage. And we'll just have to see how we go there in terms of connectivity.
Yeah, because we're trialling. Hopefully, I'll have a plan for this by the end of the week. But there's the same system that we'll use in Antarctica. If this, we can practice using this in Yukon, that would be great, because it means we'll not only be able to send pictures, but also little videos. And I'm not sure, can't guarantee, but there could be some live stuff going on. But not sure with the Yukon, but certainly Antarctica. I'm working with a company who has done live streaming from Antarctica before, so that would be very exciting if we can get that going. Can't guarantee yet. We need to get there.
No, we just have to hope, but we certainly will be following along.
So, we've got more
any
questions.
Any other questions?
See a few hands up.
Bridgewater. Yeah, Bridgewater. Has got a question down at Bridgewater or Boston? Go again.
Who's that?
Bridgewater. All right, Bridgewater, just hand that Orbost, away you go.
Hey Kate, just in terms of wildlife, you said you saw a polar bear track before. What type of precautions do you take?
That's a good question. Another plan that we have, we had the same plan in Spitsbergen, and which is like polar bear. There's more polar bears there than anywhere else that first trip up there. Didn't see them, but they're there, and same in Greenland. So what we had to do, we carry flares and things to scare the polar bear away. We have a bear fence, which is runs around the tent. So at night, we always have a trip wire that runs around the tent. So if you have to get outside of that, sometimes that's a bit tricky. And then the guide also has a gun, if that's required, but hopefully it's never been, like, I've never known that to have to happen, but they do carry that as a polar bear deterrent, it's called, which is some people that I worked with in Greenland a couple of weeks before we came actually had to fire the gun a couple of shots over the heads of not just one but two polar bears. So yes, it's one of those things you have to be wary. Obviously, in Antarctica, there are no polar bears, only penguins, and I don't think we'll have killer penguins down there. That'd be fine. So, polar bears in the Arctic, hopefully we'll see some other wildlife. Certainly, lots of caribou, and that's the livelihood of the indigenous people around there. They use every part of the caribou. That's what they live off, herding caribou and all the products that they can create from there. So, I'm hoping to sort of see that and learn a little bit of what they do. It could be all sorts of things, foxes, eagles, but Antarctica's just penguins and a few different birds, and that's about it. And the penguins really only on the coast, so you're not really going to see a lot of wildlife unless I start the journey from the actual sea, which is another thought at this stage. So,
Which is going to be a real challenge for you, Kate, isn't it? The sort of remoteness and barrenness of Antarctica, yet the beauty of Antarctica, it will be an incredible journey.
I can't wait. I mean, just this, I mean, I quite like open spaces. If you've traveled enough through the Australian desert, it's sort of quite okay with my own company. But here we've got a team. We're not going to meet other people, so we're not meeting other cultures really, but it's more about dealing and working with the environment, not against it. There might be some days where we can't go out because the weather's too bad. But in the summer in Antarctica, we know that if there's a really bad storm, it doesn't usually last more than 3 days, so it won't stop too much. It's just working with the environment and trying to work out, you know, what I can actually do to get through and how to adapt to the cold and the altitude and the wind, and making sure the bike works. You know, I'll be carrying two bikes down there, not just one, a spare bike. Might as well, we've got a vehicle that we can do it. So I'm actually trialling a brand new bike. It's just on its way between the US and Canada right now. And this bike's going to have a ski, and we're just trialling it, it's just a test. So if you imagine like a paddle steamer on the front wheel, so it's a little short, like a snowboard ski, but shorter, and it's cut a slit in it. So this isn't how I haven't seen it yet. So basically I can still get the benefit of the front wheel drive, but when I sink down to where it's too soft, it's going to add some more flotation. And it won't be good all the time, and it'll be removable and hopefully an adjustable height. But if it could add flotation when it's really soft, then, you know, we'll go a little bit further. It could be just too difficult and too cumbersome. I don't know. But Antarctica, the snow will still be different to how we'll find it in Yukon. So Antarctica is very, very dry and very granular and very almost bottomless in some, not bottomless, but very soft in closer to the pole. So that's where someone who cycled this year in Antarctica gave me a lot of feedback about that. So it's still possible, but maybe he just used a normal bike, not a two-wheel drive system, and not with a ski. So my bike will be better. Yeah.
Well, that'll be very interesting to see how all that goes from there. Might be a bit of a challenge for some of our students to have a think about that design that Kate was explaining, and see if you can actually come up with a drawing of what that bike might look like, and to be thinking about other designs that might assist Kate. You just might come up with a great design to, for a bike that might help her out.
I look forward to
along the way
to seeing some of those. That'd be great if they could share them also online. That would be great. And you can get it if you can go even to my website as well. There's some blogs and things that have pictures of the bikes, lots of pictures of the bikes, so you could have a look and see what they are and how the little systems work, from the driving, from the rear hub to the head tube, and it crosses over. The workings are very, very clear. There's actually the little video I think I put on the blog.
It shows it
really, really well. Yeah, actually. So you could have a look at that, because it's got a cutaway of a bike and how it works.
Yeah. Cool. So. Any other questions? Well, we're quickly running out of time. It's winding down. Bridgewater, we got some merino.
What if you get flat tires?
That's a good question. Luckily, in the snow, you don't tend to get as many flat tires, because there isn't so many chances of getting punctures. But it is possible, and my tires are tubeless. So it means if I get a flat tire and it's very cold and you're trying to change the tire, I've got a spare tube that I just quickly put the tube in, and then I try and fix the tire a bit later. Then I have to fix it like a normal puncture, where you have a little patch and you have some glue, and you try to do that in a warmer environment in the tent would be better. So it'd be very frustrating to get a puncture, and very difficult, because when you're in the very cold and you've got to use your hands, you can't just pull your hands out of the gloves and out of the mitts and things. You've got to keep them and do all of those things in the gloves. So it becomes a very awkward thing to do. So it's a very good question. Another thing I can add to that is that the tires that I use in the snow are very special, and they're made of a special compound, and I have to still change the pressure in the tires to make the tires, when it's very soft, I make the tires also very soft, and when it's hard, if it was ice, I'd make the tires harder and pump them up a bit more again, because that's the best way to get through. So I've gone off track again. But tires are important,
and you've got to be able to fix them all yourself. You can't run down to the corner shop or get somebody else to do it.
No.
You've got to the spare parts on the way. It comes back to your planning and preparation, which is great. All right, last chance for any other question around?
Questions?
That we might have? All right, Good one.
No. That's all pretty good. Oh, no, we've got all busted again.
Kate, will you be writing a book about your new expedition?
I'd like to. I'm talking with a publisher now, but I need to be able to do the expedition first. But I think with all of my these main journeys, it's really important to be able to communicate them and to get them down. It's just as important afterwards, otherwise they'll just be forgotten. So, it'll be important to write a book, and I'll definitely do that. And we'll, because I have a very good filmmaker, we have a very good chance of this time of getting a good documentary up and running. Whether it's going to be in the cinemas or whether it's on the telly, I don't know yet. But he's capturing it all, and he's very famous. If you ever watched, there's some journeys by the actor Ewan McGregor and Charlie Borman on their motorbikes that went around the world. The first one, a long way around, and the second one, they went down through Africa. And Claudio, he made those with Ewan McGregor and Charlie Borman. So that's what he's quite famous for that. But he does a lot of really special other things. He's an amazing guy to work with. I'm a bit lucky to have him. But he just likes to do real stories, he said, and that's why he's working with me, because it's real. It's not, and you know, it's not being made up. It's actually got a good purpose and incredible purpose, and he likes it. So I'm lucky.
All right, that's great. All right, I'm just going to share the blog. Hopefully you've been to our website, our blog, kateleeming.global2. Kate's been going onto the blog, and she's been putting lots and lots of information up there that you can have a look around at, which would be great. A couple of things I want to draw your attention to is some of the learning resources. Now, on the learning resources page, there's a camp planning learning task for the VC Outdoor and Ed studies. There is also an online quiz, what is your ecological footprint? So we can start to look at that. There's also some information around a unit of work on climate change and the environment, which Kate is very much into. Then there is also some information that Kate has put up to there. And Kate, would you like to briefly talk towards this information?
Well, it's just really good. Last year there was an expedition that went sort of in the similar region to where I'm going, and they created an education program, so it's just easy. They've got some great resources. So go back a little bit. Roald Amundsen is the first person to have walked to the South Pole. He went to the South Pole in, was it 1911 or 1912? Before that, he was the first person to discover the Northwest Passage, which is the journey, the route between across the north of Canada from near Greenland across to near Alaska. And he managed to do this before he went to the South Pole. And this expedition was tracing one of his journeys. When he got to this place, Herschel Island, which I hope to get to, his little boat became stuck in the ice, and he wanted to go and tell the world that he'd just traversed the Northwest Passage. So he did this expedition of about 1,100 kilometres down to a place called Eagle in Alaska to tell the world. And so this expedition was retracing that route, and you can go to that website and have a look. It's pretty interesting. But also, it'd be pretty good to have a look at some of those, some of their resources, because it'll be useful when I'm sort of going in a similar region to where that expedition went, you know, to be able to look it up. So there's a little bit on climate change, a little bit,
Good.
They weren't cycling, really, by stuff. The way. Yeah, they weren't cycling. You know, they're doing it the easy way with dog sleds, but, each to their own.
All right, now there's something else that Kate would, okay, and myself in particular, would like you to be thinking about, and that is about perhaps getting inspired to organise your own exhibition or fundraising effort. And no matter whether it's a large expedition where you're going to cross Antarctica, or whether it's just a small fundraising effort, I still think you really need to be thinking about Kate's term that she used earlier, and that was dream. All right, and if you remember the dream, she's got to be dedicated, realistic, enthusiastic, etc. So you still have to go through those steps. And there's also some other information there around 10 steps to organising fundraising events. And we'd love you to think about it. Or you might be organising a camp, you might be organising a bushwalk, you might be organising a cycle with a cycle-on might be coming up within your school, and so you might be riding across town, across your shire, wherever it might be. We would love to see what your expedition or your event looked like, just like Kate's going to be recording hers. We would like you to record some of yours and send some video footage or write journals, take photographs, then you can send them in to me. That'd be fantastic. We'd like you to take some action. And we're going to be following Kate along the journeys. Hopefully, if we can't get Kate in live, we'll certainly be having her following what she does online when she makes posts from time to time. And I'll be keeping in contact with her as much as I possibly can, and I will be keeping the rest of you in contact with Kate. So we'll see how we go with all that, but it is exciting. It's exciting to be able to talk to someone who's heading off on an expedition, is in the middle of planning it, of trying to get the funds together, and when she actually gets there and successfully completes it, we'll all be able to say, we were there with Kate at the start. We saw her. And we were following her and cheering along. So I urge you to go to the blog. Before I do, I'll just quickly jump back to that. We would like you to communicate with Kate. And so under the Communicate tab, Kate's done a first blog, and we would love to see you go on there and leave a reply. So you can go onto there, leave a reply, make a comment. And as the comments come in here, Kate will get back and respond to those comments as soon as she possibly can, while she's not riding her bike, trying to raise money, getting the planning done, and all those things. But she will get back. All right. Well, that just about runs out of time. Kate, thank you very, very much for your time today.
Thank you.
That's a pleasure, everyone.
Good on you guys down in Maroona. We've got our own little expedition happening here. We're going right across the state from Maroona, southwest to Bridgewater. Lovely Bridgewater on the Loddon River down there. Okay, there. And then all the way down to Orbost. Good stuff, guys.
That's a pleasure. That's a pleasure. Thanks for listening. We'll keep in touch, huh?
Bye.
Yeah. Bye.
Bye.
And hopefully we'll have another follow-up session before too long. We'll see how we go, and I'll keep in contact with the schools around that of when we can get to have another session with Kate.